How might we go about finding the surface area of a function being revolved around a line? Well, if we look at this function in the pink, and we start to revolve it around the x-axis, we see that it looks like that function is being stacked on top of itself many, many times as it revolves. So this might lead us to think that perhaps the length of that function has something to do with finding the surface area of the function being revolved around the x-axis. It's going to be easiest to calculate the surface area of an object that we already know how to find the surface area of from geometry. So we're going to start with a line as our function. And we're going to revolve this function in order to create a cone. So this cone is this line being stacked on itself many, many times as we go around. So let's take a closer look at this cone. We know our function is a line, and we're going to call this point B, which we know in our cone would be equal to our height. And we're going to call this point F of B, which we know would be equal to our radius in a cone. And this function here is equal to a slope, which in this case we could call f of b over b, because the slope here is the change in y is f of b minus 0 over the change in x, b minus 0. So that gives us f of b over b times x, and the y-intercept is at 0, 0, so we don't have to worry about that. And now, using this, we know that the surface area of a cone, which will be formed when this line is revolved around the x-axis, is pi times the radius, which is f of b, times the length of this line. So forming a right triangle, we can find that the length of that line, the square root of b squared plus f of b squared. Now let's try something harder. Suppose we have that same cone, but instead of finding the surface area of the whole cone, we're going to chop off the bottom part of the cone, so we're only looking for the surface area of this part of the cone. So that means that we can draw this as two cones. We have the smaller cone, and we have the larger cone. And the area of the top part of the cone, which we call a frustum, is going to be the surface area of our big cone, which we'll call B, minus the surface area of our small cone, which we'll call A. So let's label some points. So this is going to be B, and this is going to be A. So that means that the surface area of B is equal to pi times f of b times the square root of b squared plus f of b squared. And we know that the surface area of a is equal to pi times f of a times the square root of a squared plus f of a squared. Now, our function for this line is some slope, which we'll call c, times x. So that means that the surface area for b is equal to pi times c times b times the square root of b squared plus c times b quantity squared. And the surface area of a is pi times c times a times the square root of a squared plus the quantity c times a squared. So now, just like we did when we were finding the length of a curve, we can factor out a b squared and an a squared. So that's going to give us surface area of b equals pi times c times b squared times the square root of 1 plus c squared. And the surface area of a is pi times c times a squared times the square root of 1 plus c squared. So now we can subtract the surface area of a from the surface area of b. So s sub b minus f sub a equals pi times c times b squared times the square root of 1 plus c squared minus pi times c times a squared times the square root of 1 plus c squared. And we're going to factor out pi, c, and the square root of 1 plus c squared all times b squared minus a squared. Now, we can factor b minus a squared, so that's going to give us pi times c times the square root of 1 plus c squared times b minus a times b plus a. And now we're going to factor this c in to have c times b plus c times a. So pi times the square root of 1 plus c squared times b minus a times c times b plus c times a. And you'll notice that this is f of b, c times b is f of b, and c times a is f of a. So now that gives us pi times the square root of 1 plus c squared times b minus a times f of b plus f of a. And if you do some more finagling, you'll find that this part right here is equal to the length of L. So again, we have pi times our radius times the length of L. In order to find the surface area of other solids of revolution, we can use the method we used to find the surface area of frustums to approximate the surface area of various slices of our surface of revolution. So in this case, you can see lots of tiny little chunks that look like frustums. So if we have a bunch of frustums, we know the surface area of a frustum is pi times f of b plus f of a times L, which is the length of the line that we are rotating. So the length of that line L on our frustum, if we draw a right triangle and we still have points B and A, we know that the length horizontally is going to be B minus A, and the length vertically is going to be F of B minus F of A. We can call F of B minus F of A the change in Y, and we can call B minus A the change in X. So that means that the length is equal to the square root of the change in X quantity squared plus the change in Y squared. And just like we did with arc length, we can factor out a change in x squared to get the length equals the square root of 1 plus the change in y over the change in x squared times the change in x. And the change in y over the change in x, again, just like arc length, we can write that as f prime of x. So that means the L equals the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared times delta x. So our whole surface area equals pi times f of b plus f of a times the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared times delta x. And as our change in x goes to 0, f of b and f of a are going to get very close together, so that means that we can rewrite this as it's approximately 2 f of x. The surface area equals 2 pi times f of x times the square root of 1 plus f prime of x quantity squared times the change in x. And we're adding a whole bunch of these frustums up, so we get the sum of 2 pi f of x times the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared times delta x. And we're going to let our number of frustums go to infinity. We have a definition for the area of surface of revolution. Let f be differentiable and positive on the closed interval a to b. the area of the surface generated when the graph of f on the closed interval a to b is revolved around the x-axis is s equals the integral from a to b of 2 pi f of x times the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared dx.